Normally I speak about climate change, but I was really excited to be here and to talk about climate instead. So some of you may be aware that we are now in an El Nino, or you may have heard that one is coming. And El Nino has sort of become the poster child for weird climate stuff. I think Saturday Night Live may have had something to do with that. And I hear a lot of people out on the West Coast who say, oh, El Nino is coming, we're gonna get rain. I'm gonna get to that, but first I wanna tell you what El Nino is and how we know what it is, which are actually not two separate things. El Nino is a pattern. That's the simplest explanation I can give you. But as you may have discovered, sometimes we see what we're looking for, and it can be difficult to determine what's the pattern and what's the variation and what's normal. So first I want to talk about the default world of the Pacific Ocean. You might think that normal for an ocean would be, you know, just kind of sitting there as oceans do. But there's actually a lot going on. What's normal for the Pacific is to be in this dynamic state of just being balanced, just ready to let go. What's happening is that because the sun hits us most directly at the equator, the water there gets warmer. Warm water, warm air, it evaporates. And so you get circulation, north-south and also east-west. Because the Earth is turning, everything gets pulled together at the equator, which is called the intertropical convergence zone because everything converges in the middle of the tropics. And that's normal in the Pacific. It's normal to have this huge amount of wind pushing from east to west. So there's actually a difference in sea level from east to west. If you could walk on the water, you'd have to walk uphill to get from Peru to Australia. And that has a really major impact on the people who live there. In the Western Pacific, where all the water is being pushed, it's warm. Think about it as like this big puddle of warm water just sitting there. It's called the Western Pacific Warm Pool for that reason. On the east side, though, you've got the opposite situation. You're constantly moving the top layer of water off. You can't have a big hole in the ocean, so cold water has to come up from underneath. This means that swimming off the coast of Peru is kind of chilly, but it's really good for the fishermen there. Fish don't actually care as much about the temperature of the water, but water from underneath, cold water, has nutrients in it. So that's the Pacific's normal situation. The winds are blowing, which maintains a pool of warm water in the west and cold water in the east. Of course, you might want to ask, well, okay, what sets up those winds? And the answer, of course, is, well, there's warm water in the west and cold water in the east, which causes the winds to blow. This is how oceanography works. The oceanographers and the atmospheric scientists go back and forth trying to say, you know, which one's really more important. And of course, there isn't really an answer to that. So we have the winds set up by the water and the water set up by the winds. But when something comes and perturbs that, the whole system can break down. And when the winds stop blowing, don't worry about why for the moment, just go with it, the winds stop blowing, all that warm water that's been pushed to the west, there's nothing to push it anymore. So it's gonna slosh back across the Pacific Ocean. So now instead of this dynamic situation where you have to walk uphill from Peru to Australia, it's flat. Everything's even. And that is not normal for the Pacific. That is what we now call an El Nino. So before El Nino was a punchline or a scientific term even, it was something the Peruvian fishermen noticed. They noticed there was a current that would sometimes switch directions. When it did so, it was generally around Christmas time, so they named it for the Christ child. That is why it is called El Nino. And this was known for a very long time before Western scientists kind of got involved and started connecting what was going on in Peru to much larger things going on across the Pacific. And it turns out that much like this current that can flop back and forth, there's a pressure difference in the atmosphere that seesaws in the same way. When those two things are in sync, that's how you get a real El Nino event. We call it ENSO, which stands for El Nino Southern Oscillation. Southern Oscillation is the atmospheric part. So last year you might have heard people talking, oh, there's going to be an El Nino. No, there isn't. And to oversimplify, that's because the atmosphere wasn't really playing along. So we have this condition in which the winds weaken, the water sloshes back, and now everything's kind of flat. It's easy to forget just how large the Pacific Ocean is. You can hold a globe and turn it so that pretty much all you can see is the Pacific Ocean. So although El Nino is a Pacific phenomenon, it actually affects people around the world. It can be associated with flooding, it can be associated with droughts, it has an impact on crops. So you can imagine that predicting it could first of all prevent a lot of suffering, could prevent a lot of famine, and be really cool to get it right. So for a long time there was this push, yeah, we're gonna understand El Nino. If we can make a good enough mathematical model, we can predict it. And they tried and worked really hard, and they were very, very wrong. It was a really spectacular disaster. They said, oh, there's not gonna be an El Nino. And then there was the largest one anyone had ever seen. All right, but you try again, right? You don't get it right, that's okay. And the idea was, well, let's put instruments out in the ocean. Let's see what's actually happening. It turns out that El Nino isn't just happening off the coast of Peru. It actually takes up the entire Pacific. And there's a region that we like to keep track of on the equator. And when it starts to get warm, that usually means you're in an El Nino. So they put out instrumentation, and the idea was, okay, we're gonna catch this one in advance. And sure enough, they saw a big temperature spike, but it was too big to be an El Nino. So they said, well, that's unfortunate. I guess our equipment isn't working. And a couple people said, well, no, that could be an El Nino. And one of the most important scientists at the time, Klaus Wertke, who's unfortunately deceased, said it is not an El Nino, and to call this an El Nino would be a case of child abuse. It's worth remembering that scientists are people too. He was wrong. It turned out to be a really spectacular El Nino, but that was the one that really allowed us to understand how it works. So although I'm telling you about mistakes, we should all fail that well. Because that kind of failure sets you up to do it better next time. And we have gotten much better at predicting El Nino and predicting what its effects will be. I'll briefly mention that there is an opposite condition, where instead of the winds in the Pacific weakening and everything getting flat, the winds get stronger. The steep hill gets steeper, everything gets stronger. It's a more intense situation. So they were looking for a name that was the opposite of El Nino. And one of the early suggestions was El Diablo, which I think would have been better. But we have La Niña instead. So the female is the strong condition, the warm condition, and El Niño, the boy, is the weak condition where everything goes flat. So that's how we got to this idea of El Niño. And now the term is used sometimes to mean El Niño, the cold, weak one, or sometimes to mean that whole phenomenon that has something to do with El Niño, including La Niña. So we have managed to make the name of this thing remarkably complicated. But that's okay, because the math is actually really complicated. The problem with defining El Niño is that every time someone comes up with a great definition, something happens and, well, that actually doesn't fit the definition, but I'm pretty sure it's an El Niño. So we're constantly moving the goalposts. It's one of those you can kind of tell when you're in it. But it's worth taking a step back and realizing that we've decided that every time the Pacific starts to flatten out, it must be the same phenomenon. And so we've decided to name it El Niño. And there's actually some evidence that there are different types of El Niños. The reason we've been able to do so much of this is that pattern recognition, which is so important to us as humans, can be really hard to do objectively. Again, we often see what we want to see. But it turns out mathematically you can look at patterns. It's called principal component analysis, and what you get are modes. What you get are ways that the ocean or atmosphere or whatever you're analyzing like to exist. And it turns out that, yeah, this El Niño pattern, which we're going to only define loosely as it's warm where it isn't usually, happens about once every 4 years or so. Every time we think we get a pattern going, something else happens, and it turns out that was actually not the pattern. So we're still struggling to come up with a really good definition. But now I want to tell you what it means for people, especially on the West Coast. You may be aware that California is in a drought. Some people are really excited about this El Nino. I'm really excited about this El Nino, but that's because I love El Nino. El Nino is associated with rain in Southern California. It does not cause rain in Southern California. You can think of it as a probabilistic thing. And this is the big thing that people have trouble with understanding about climate. And if you can understand more or less how climate works, the climate change stuff is actually really easy, and I can explain it to you later. So as it turns out, you can't say that an event is caused by one thing. You're like, well, no, frequently events are caused by things. But I want you to think about the example of your favorite baseball player who was caught using steroids. You can't say, well, that home run, that one was due to the steroids, but not the one the day before. Obviously, if the guy couldn't hit home runs, he would not have been a professional baseball player. But you are kind of weighting the deck. You are kind of stacking things a little bit by using those steroids. And that's what's going on in our climate system. El Nino is not going to cause much. It will, however, make a variety of things more likely. Yes, one of those is rain in California. No, that will not solve the problem that was created by putting a lot of agriculture into a desert. That is not a problem that has a solution of the type of, oh, we solved it. I love problems that have that kind of solution, but climate does not seem to give us a lot of those. So I want to leave you just with this idea that our climate's normal system is to constantly be doing these pushes and pulls back and forth. And we go around and try to name these phenomena wherever we see them, because it's frankly easier to talk about things if you have names for them. And as we go into this El Nino, I suspect you'll hear about it on the news, and you'll hear all sorts of things attributed to it. But just keep in mind that the way we see patterns is a lot about the way we want to see patterns. And in the Pacific Ocean, we're still figuring out what normal is and what the deviations are. Thank you.